Harper Audio presents Whipping Boy, The 40-Year Search for My 12-Year-Old Bully. Written and read by Allen Kurzweil. Dedication. In memory of my father, for the things he invented, with gratitude to my mother, for the things she preserved. This is a work of nonfiction. No names, none, have been changed. Part 1. Switzerland. In the little world in which children have their existence, whosoever brings them up, there is nothing so finely perceived and so finely felt as injustice. Charles Dickens, Great Expectations. My youthful innocence suffered an injury. It was a slight scratch, which in the course of time grew into a gaping wound that cut deep into my flesh and did not close. Hans Kielsen, The Death of the Adversary. Confession. You've been a menace and a muse, a beacon and a roadblock, my jailer and my travel agent. You have this uncanny habit of popping up in the most unexpected places. During a walk through the Louvre, at the back of a bar, in the lyrics of a Broadway show tune. If the Da Vinci Code shows up on TV, or if I'm playing foosball with my son, if I spot a certain kind of fountain pen or a particular brand of wristwatch, there's a good chance I'll find myself thinking of you. The prompts aren't always that subtle. A few years back, a credit card company website summoned the obsession directly with this password hint. Who was your arch rival when you were growing up? Without a second thought, I entered the name of the boy who entered my life when I was 10 years old, entered my life and reshaped it forever. C-E-S-A-R-A-U-G-U-S-T-U-S. Cesar Augustus. Rules and ranks. Even if I hadn't bunked with a kid named Cesar Augustus, memories of the Swiss boarding school that brought us together surely would have stuck. The eccentric imperatives of the institution's forward-thinking founder and the exotic backgrounds of the teachers he employed. The daily meditations promoting liberty and the 36-page handbook that curtailed it. The lessons in swordsmanship and elocution. The alpine expeditions. The cold showers and soybean steaks. All of it was way too strange to forget. Established on a mountain plain high above Geneva in 1949, Eglon College was the brainchild of John Corlett, a headstrong, asthmatic Englishman with a singular vision of what boarding school should be. Regimented, yet free-spirited. Full of fearless high-altitude adventure and moral enlightenment. J.C., yep, that's how the founder chose to be addressed, believed physical fitness and spiritual reflection nurtured body and soul, and that obedience was a prerequisite for independence. Freedom, he declared, is an exceedingly difficult commodity to handle. To do so requires very strict training and discipline, and at Eglon such training and discipline are not only provided, they are enjoyed. Well, not by me, they weren't. As the school's youngest pupil, the runt of the litter, I found myself at the very bottom of a pseudo-military pyramid codified in the aforementioned handbook. I received a copy of Rules and Ranks the day I arrived, September 1, 1971, and was given a written test on its contents a few weeks later. Every lower schooler entered Eglon a so-called no rank, with promotion to junior green badge summarily awarded to all but the most non-compliant plebe. The appearance of hard work, academic achievement, physical prowess, or moral rectitude, translation, brown-nosing, paved the way for further upgrades, first to Junior Red Badge, then to Silver Eagle, and from there to the lofty rank of Golden Eagle. A new sweater pin accompanied each promotion, as did a correlative bump in the pocket money handed out each Wednesday afternoon. Upper schoolers could climb even higher through JC's rank system by becoming standard bearer candidates, then standard bearers, then captains, and finally, for the two most even-keeled and charismatic pupils in the school, head girl and guardian, the latter honorific optimistically filched from Plato's Republic. Nuanced enough? Not for JC. He tweaked the protocol further by introducing stars. I recall this small refinement because the school council promoted me to junior green badge star soon after I took first place at a regional track meet. 2 months later, however, I was stripped of the spangle when a dining hall monitor caught me shirking my duties. And as a junior red badge star, the highest rank I achieved, my weekly pay, was pegged at 5 Swiss francs, or roughly $1.25. Although the school took care of the cost of laundry, haircuts, postage, and paper, it was up to me to cover all miscellaneous expenses. And at Eglon, those expenses included fines. Say the house captain caught me flicking a towel, or the dining hall monitor noticed I was tilting backward in my chair. Suppose the outside tidiness captain found grease on my camping gear, or his residential counterpart observed that I'd left a light on during the day. Any one of those slip-ups could trigger a fine of 20 to 50 centimes. And don't for a second think a parent could cover those charges. External financial assistance was, at least in principle, banned from campus. The moment a student is given extra sums of money over and above his earned income, the education value of the system is destroyed, JC noted in a brochure sent to my mother. The regulations tied to this apocalyptic premise were spelled out in the money and trade section of the rules. All and any currency exceeding 5 francs in total value must be handed in to your housemaster at the beginning of each term. Any other money received by you during the term for birthdays, etc., must be handed in at once. I was 10 and terrified. I obeyed JC's monetary restrictions, but most older students did not. Eglon sustained a robust, black market economy dependent on all sorts of unsanctioned revenue streams. Cesar, for example, did a brisk business reselling movie posters and pocket knives. But heaven help anyone who got caught with outside funds in excess of 9 francs, or about $2. One of the nicest and most respected seniors, nabbed in flagrante delicto with a diner's club card, got the boot 2 weeks before he was to graduate. Money wasn't the school's only mechanism of control. Public tally boards also instilled discipline. Red marks, earned for feats of physical, spiritual, or academic virtue, signaled success and paved the way for promotions and bonds. Tissue paper vouchers distributed by housemasters and accepted among local shopkeepers in lieu of cash. Black marks, on the other hand, could result in a pensum, a 2-page assignment on a subject of the prefect's choosing, the virtues of thrift, for example, or the sex life of the sandfly. Since I was too young to be saddled with written penalties, my waywardness usually resulted in lapse, punishment runs requiring me to dash to a stone bridge and back, a hillside circuit of about a mile. Late for class? Lapse. In the hallway after lights out? Lapse. Spotted crossing the invisible 1-meter barrier surrounding the assistant housemaster's VW bug? Caught being slimy? Caught exhibiting loutish behavior? Caught urinating on a football pitch? Lapse, lapse, and more lapse. The surveillance wasn't restricted to adults. Each of the school's 5 alphabetically named houses, Alpena, Belvedere, Claremont, Delaware, and Exeter, operated under its own student-run bureaucracy. House captains managed prefects, prefects kept tabs on monitors, and monitors oversaw the rest of us. Everyone had at least one house chore. Besides serving as a yogurt carrier, a low-level job not to be confused with the more exalted position of yogurt checker, I was compelled to provide assistance to a shower monitor, a boy with an imperial name. Wienerwald. So let's rewind for a moment. How does a 10-year-old Jewish kid from New York end up at a Swiss boarding school founded by a mystically inclined Christian Englishman? For years, I had a ready response to that question. My mom warehoused me in Eglon while she was test driving her third husband. But that glibness is misleading and unfair. I wanted to go to Eglon. I campaigned to attend. And I did so for reasons that can be traced back to the alpine passions of another 10-year-old Jewish kid. My father, born in Vienna in 1911, was raised to love the mountains. In a journal he kept as a young boy, he drew pictures inspired by his weekend hikes through the Vienna woods, sketches of mountain ranges, flowers, snowdrops in particular, hound dogs, and deer. When he turned 12, my father joined the local chapter of a socialist scouting organization called the Rote Falken, or Red Hawks. With like-minded leftists, he hiked, rope-climbed, and skied the Wienerwald and the Alps. Those adventures and pretty much every other pleasure in his life ceased once Hitler came to power. In 1938, my father was arrested, along with most of his comrades. Yet unlike them, he managed to get himself released. Soon after, he fled to England. The details of his escape are fuzzy. And from there, emigrated to the United States, where he found work as a mechanical engineer. After the war, my father returned to Europe under the European Recovery Program, known informally as the Marshall Plan. Whenever he wasn't designing machinery, everything from room-sized metal lathes to a tabletop automatic orange juicer, he'd head for the Alps. By 1958, he had lined up enough consulting work among Italian machine tool manufacturers to resettle in Milan with his second wife, my mother, two stepchildren, and a pair of handmade hiking boots. I was born 2 years later. All of which is a roundabout way of explaining why I spent winter holidays in Switzerland. My father would load Mom, my much older half-siblings Ron and Vivian, and me into his Chevy Impala, an elegant, powerful, and generously proportioned first-generation import purchased by an engineer who was himself an elegant, powerful, and generously proportioned first-generation import. He'd then drive the family to Villars, a sleepy village in the Vaud, a French-speaking canton celebrated for its watchmakers, ski slopes, and international boarding schools. A preference for the rustic charms of Villars over the glitz of Gstaad or St. Moritz shouldn't suggest that my father was immune to luxury. Quite the opposite. A classic example of what the Swiss call a couple socialiste, or champagne socialist, he spent lavishly on friends and family and, in particular, on me. While his generosity found expression throughout the year, my father, lapsed Jew that he was, waited until Christmas time to go whole hog, transforming the Villars of my childhood into a life-size snow globe filled with stiff animals, Lego bricks, Marklin trains, milk chocolate, and candy. It was my father who introduced me to Sugus taffies, a superior antecedent to Starbursts. Dad was particularly immoderate when it came to winter gear. My closet in Milan quickly filled with goose-down snowsuits and double-bladed skates, wooden skis, and leather lace-up boots small enough to have hung from the Chevy's rear-view mirror. Not that Dad himself did much skiing or hiking by the time I came along. Arteriosclerosis and severe angina made prolonged exertion impossible. And yet, even in sickness, he found a way to honor the Alps. He kept his meds in a silver pillbox shaped like the iconic whiskey cask associated with St. Bernard dogs, once bred for alpine rescue. When I turned 4, my father had a heart exam. That exam led to further tests, and the tests revealed he had cancer. He rejected the treatment options recommended by the local doctors, arguing that Italian hospitals were far more life-threatening than any disease. When my mother finally strong-armed him into consulting an oncologist in the United States, it was too late. Dad spent his final Christmas in a New York hospital bed and died in a morphine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.